The next talk will be given by Carsten Koenig, who is Professor of Physics at Saarland University and Chief Executive Officer of the company Yenlab in Germany, and he will be talking about clinical multiphoton tomography.
Yeah, I would like to talk about optical biopsies in humans using femtosecond lasers. And in fact, you can get very high resolution in the range of less than 1 micrometer. For example, here you see one single cell from my left arm deep in the tissue. And what you see is, in fact, NADH. We heard about this from Britton Chance. This is NADH, which we can image deep in the tissue using near-infrared multiphoton processes. And these two-photon excitation or multiphoton excitation processes were predicted already 80 years ago by a young German PhD student, Maria Göppert, in Göttingen, 1930. The same year, she moved to the United States and became finally professor in San Diego in 1960, and 3 years later, the Nobel Prize. She had a idea that there's a simultaneous absorption of two photons, and in principle you can get a visible fluorescence out from this non-resonant two-photon process. However, at that time there was no light source available to show that this is possible, and we had to wait until the laser was invented in 1960, and very shortly after this invention, Kaiser and Garrett demonstrated two-photon fluorescence in crystals. And it took another 30 years to apply two-photon processes to biomedicine. And Denk, Strickler, and Webb invented the two-photon microscope, published in Science, and filed a variety of patents. And very soon later, a variety of research groups, such as from Masterso and Cretong, started to show two-photon excited fluorescence in tissues. And we tried to realize, finally, a clinical system very shortly, so it just took 10 years after Denk's two-photon microscope. We filed a patent and published then in SPIE proceedings and in GBO about the first multiphoton tomograph, which is a medical product and used nowadays in 20 clinics and research institutions in Australia, Japan, Europe, and now also in the United States. We have now a second type of multiphoton tomograph, and this is based on a MITAI femtosecond laser system. It's tunable, and the laser, as well as the chiller, is in this particular system. If you look more carefully for this scan head, you will see that there are two PMTs in the scan head. We have a galvo scanner in it, a piezo-driven objective of high NA 1.3, and we have an active beam stabilizer. How safe is the application of femtosecond laser pulses? In fact, we work with 80 megahertz, so 80 million pulses per second, but we apply very low pulse energy in the range of some picojoules. That means a mean power in the range of 2 to 49 milliwatt. We can go down to 200 micrometer, and in that depth, we can apply 49 milliwatt at the surface. The typical beam dwell time is just in the range of some microseconds, and it took about 1 to 12 seconds per optical section. And there were 2-year studies going on to show how safe it is. And one of the studies, for example, is published by the company Beiersdorf, Frank Fischer, in Journal of Biomedical Optics. They compared UV lamp exposure to mimic sunlights and UV lamps used in tanning studies to compare it with the femtosecond laser systems. And they figured out the UV lamp is, in that case, has a higher damage potential. And if you do it right with your picojoule femtosecond laser pulses, it's the same as you would walk outside for 50 minutes in sunny California. What can you do? You can now excite a variety of endogenous fluorophores, and we have single photon counting systems, so we can indeed measure now and image NADH free as well as bound. There's a different fluorescence lifetime. We can see flavins, we can see elastin, and also collagen. And there's another process called second harmonic generation, so nicely we can image collagen by SEG. And also melanin has a nice fluorescence as well as a variety of perforins. As I mentioned, now you can see deep in the tissue single cells, you see the non-fluorescent nucleus, and you see a variety of organelles, mitochondria containing NADH. If you go deeper to the dermis, you see single elastin fibers and you see collagen. And the lateral resolution is better than half a micron, and axial resolution it's 1 to 2 microns. Interestingly, you can also see single cancer cells, in particular these melanocytes. Melanin is a fluorophore, and in particular in patients with malignant melanoma, you see many of these melanocytes in different tissue layers. So in principle, what people, for example, in Brisbane, Australia, as well as in Jena are doing is to try to figure out, is that a method for early diagnosis of melanoma? And they look into a variety of nevi. We heard about fluorescence lifetime measurements. If you have already a femtosecond laser system, then it's relatively easy to integrate now very fast photomultipliers and to do time-resolved single photon counting per pixel. Then we calculate a mean fluorescence lifetime and depict this as a color. So in red, 700 picoseconds, in that case, blue, 3 nanoseconds. And you can apply that for a variety of studies, research, to use it for a variety of skin diseases. And for example, Imperial College is trying to look also in patients with melanoma using multiple PMTs in different spectral ranges and to do spectral FLIM in clinics on patients. Another application is to look for dermatitis, in particular for very young patients, and 80% of these cases occur in very young patients. You don't want to take biopsies, and you don't want to start with an immediate treatment, such as with cortisone. So we look for with a multiphoton tomograph in these lesions. In particular, this work is done in Münster, Mannheim, and Heidelberg. And they found that the mean fluorescence lifetime correlates with disease with certain clinical parameters called SCORAD. And interestingly, they try also to measure now the treatment effects. And normally such a treatment can take several weeks or months, and they are able now to see if the treatment effect is successful by a reduction of the mean fluorescence lifetime. And there are other talks during this conference showing that very precisely by statistics of about 14,000 FLIM images taken from patients. Another interesting question is it possible to measure the age of the skin? You can do it in vivo by measuring the ratio of elastin to collagen. So we measure the autofluorescence versus second harmonic generation. And if you want to measure in particular in the facial range, then we apply a two-photon microendoscope. Very interesting is a combination of a variety of state-of-the-art technologies for skin imaging. In particular, we combine now multiphoton tomography with ultrasound OCT, dermoscopy, and there are many groups working on these hybrid systems, in particular within European projects. So it's possible to combine with swept source technology, optoacoustics, and ultrasound, for example, and here just some examples with swept source OCT on a hemangioma. You see without any cover slips, cover glasses on it, you can also measure through the glass, and then you can look in a region of interest and start to look more in detail with high resolution using multiphoton tomography. With ultrasound, we performed also measurements up to 100 megahertz. But I think the most exciting combination is maybe the combination of two high-resolution modalities, combining in particular CARs to detect non-fluorescent molecules. And if you use femtosecond sources, it's in particular possible to measure lipids and water. On the other hand, you can get then two-photon autofluorescence and second harmonic generation. So you get also chemical fingerprints from NADH, from flavins, keratin, melanin, elastin, and collagen. And we realized the first clinical system based on a MITRE system in combination with an OPO and performed studies in the Charité in Berlin in April 2010. In particular, we looked for different lipid pattern in patients suffering from psoriasis. There are major applications in the field of diagnostics of dermatological disorders such as cancer, dermatitis, wound healing, and it's also of high interest for the cosmetic industry and the pharmaceutical industry. In principle, you can perform studies up to 3 months after topical administration. You can look if really anti-aging creams are efficient or not, and you can also look for nanoparticles, in particular in sunscreen. And for example, Professor Roberts in Australia is looking in vivo, in volunteers, how deep nanoparticles such as zinc oxide nanoparticles penetrate, for example, also in patients with psoriasis. In conclusion, multiphoton imaging technology is now in clinical use in Europe, Australia, Japan, and now also in the United States. So far, we have more than 2,000 patients and volunteers investigated. Biopsies are not required. You have a high resolution, no staining, and you get a very high resolution in the range of submicrons. You can hear more in the session about multiphoton, a session starting tomorrow, as well as in the laser exhibition, and the system is now also at the Beckman Laser Institute in Irvine. Thanks for your attention.